Bol.com is a really big e-commerce platform. At least I think that's, I hope that's a good characterization. That sells lots and lots of different products to consumers. And Maarten is going to talk a bit about their program and what they've been learning in structuring their program. And in the years that they've been working on this. I think also he was going to talk a bit about the organizational and architectural choices that they've made to make it easier to start onboarding and, you know, have the developer journey. Okay. And here's Maarten. Hi. Hoi, Maarten.
Hi. How are you?
Goedemorgen. I hope that was a good introduction.
You took a few words right out of my mouth, so I can skip a few.
Yeah,
but there's no problem. I'll go a bit more into detail, so no worries.
All right. Then I'm going to go off screen, and I'll hand over the podium. Thank you.
All right, so people can see my slides now, right?
All right. Yes, we do.
Yeah, cool. Then I'll get started. Thank you. My name is Maarten Roosendaal. I'll give you a bit of a short introduction. I've been working at Bol.com for about 10 years, and Bol.com is indeed the biggest e-commerce retailer in the Netherlands and Belgium. I've most of my time here at Bol.com, I've been an IT architect, but this year I've transitioned to a product owner role for the domain I'm going to talk about. I really like basketball, and I also love CrossFit. I'm also a level one CrossFit, so I like to get people. I get a good workout and give other people a good workout. But that's a whole other topic. So my story today, well, it's a bit of a reinvention of Bol.com. Our ambition is to become a retail tech platform with sort of a vibrant ecosystem. And it requires us to become hyper-connectable through great public APIs and the best developer experience you can imagine. However, the way we are organized and were organized and our historic perspective on e-commerce hinders that ambition. So this talk will be about which problems did we face, what we're doing about this, and how we're moving forward to achieve our ambition and also deliver a great developer experience. And at the end, I'll give you 3 takeaways which will help you if you are on the same journey. But let's start with going into a bit more in depth about Bol.com. So Bol.com has been around more than 20 years. We started in 1999 as sort of an online book company. But over the years, we've added more products, more categories. We have now over 11 million active customers with more than 22 million products, over 2,000 employees, and 1 in 2 Dutch and Belgian consumers who shop online do so at Bol.com. We've also added numerous business models over the years to stay relevant and also to differentiate from our competitors. And for this story that I'm going to go more into depth on is the Bol.com marketplace. We currently, the Bol.com marketplace is basically people can sell their products through our platform. And we have over 35,000 retailers or sellers on our platform as we speak. But in 2018, we came to sort of a conclusion that if we really want to compete and differentiate, because we see companies like Amazon, like Alibaba, etc., if we want to really compete and differentiate, then we have to transform into a retail tech platform. So before, we just were an e-commerce company with a marketplace, but we need to move to a retail tech platform. And what that exactly is a whole different topic. But I want to focus today especially on the partners side, on those marketplace partners, and more specifically on the automated partners, which brings us to the next part, and that is our public API or our public retailer API, which is the most important one to talk about. So as I said, in 2011, we started the marketplaces, and we started with the user interface, right? We were really a user interface oriented company. And we added a few big partners as a proof of concept, and it worked really well, and we added more partners. Now, at one point, an idea formed that to also make something available through an API. You know, I think that was around 2014, 15, sort of to support a niche set of partners. as sort of a side project, so nice to have. And that eventually evolved into the retailer API. So it's an automatable way of integrating the partner's e-commerce processes and systems with our functionality to sell their goods through our marketplace. Now, as I said, this was done as a sort of a nice to have side project. And over the years, we've added more stuff to the API to actually do complete, to provide complete retailing processes. Stuff like doing your orders, adding product information, fulfillment by bol.com, etc. Everything you need from a retailer perspective to sell your products. It started getting more and more traction, but we're still something on the fringes. And then also at one point, we started seeing new business models. Where certain companies started acting as integrators. And what they did was they built the integration with the API of bol.com, and they provided their own tooling for partners. But the added value of those companies was that they did not only integrate with our platform, but also with other platforms in the Netherlands and more so in other countries. So if you're a seller and you want to sell kettlebells, you can not only do it at bol.com, but in any marketplace all over the world. But again, over the years, we're still seeing something on the side, right? A public API, yeah, okay, fine, nice, but what is it really? And then sort of suddenly, quote unquote, we ended up with 11,000 API users, API retailers, which produce over 70% of all partner revenue. Now, to put that in perspective, I think that's almost half of the bol.com revenue is generated by those 11,000 API partners. So when we tell people that, they start to think like, oh, this might be something really important. But because the API was not treated as a first class citizen from the start, we basically ended up with a poor developer experience. Right? There are lots of things we could talk about, but what I said is we really focus on internal user interfaces. You can get away with a lot of bad APIs, but also the way of thinking is just different. And also how the business approaches things does not have an API first mindset or an actual platform mindset yet. And that ended up with, of course, for the external APIs, stuff like poorly written documentation, but maybe most importantly, it's illogical, incomplete, or even missing APIs. Our GUIs had more functionality than we could actually provide for the same type of partners, but we just didn't expose it to the APIs with all sorts of reasoning behind it. But yeah, so despite the problems, we still had an early mover advantage, which made us successful. So can you imagine if we treated our public APIs as really as first-class citizens? So this is not really to blame anyone, but this is how it is. Now, to solve some of the problems, we introduced an API team with the focus on the retail process. So I think that was about 2017. And I sort of jokingly put in the image of the A team. And it's not for the A, but more it sometimes feel like when they were surrounded by enemies and they had to flee into a shed, a tool shed, and 5 minutes later they come out with a tank to protect themselves and the others. And sort of that feels a bit like for us as well. We had to build a tank to protect the inside landscape from the outside, but also protect the outside landscape from the inside. So what is the tank that we built? We look at it from an IT perspective. You have a consumer on the left. It does a call, first goes through our API gateway, and that call is routed to what we call the merchant API. That is basically the tank, and that merchant API routes then the call to all backend services. I'll talk a bit about later. But this is sort of the protection of the tank that we built to make it really scalable for partners, but also for the inside, and take away a lot of pain that the inside has right now for the outside world. So to get a bit more into detail, this is some of the stuff that they did. And things like translation and aggregation, yeah, those should be on more downstream services. But because they just didn't do, we had to build some logic, all that kind of stuff in the API. Which is really what you don't want. We also improved on the documentation structure, and Kathleen before said, yeah, this is really important. I think we're maybe a level one going on level two maturity, but we have really poor documentation with poor navigation, inconsistent documentation. And the team really worked on providing a more consistent document developer experience. But just having a good navigation, a good starting point, migration guides from going from one version to the next, etc. So they improved documentation. We also had a tech writer, so hurrah for tech writers. It's, you don't know what you're missing until you've got one. And we also added the API lifecycle. So this is all the stuff that the API team did. And meanwhile, it was still seen a bit of as a side project, something on the fringes. And the last few years, people started noticing us because of the amount of money that goes through our API. But having one team is not really scalable, right? And there are lots of reasons for that. We have I'll get to that, to the architecture part a bit later. But in essence, it takes away a lot of responsibility and ownership. And if you really become a retail tech platform, and you have to have an outside-in or an API-first mindset as part of your DNA, and we have a team in the middle that solves a lot of stuff, then you will never really feel the pain or the responsibility to really have that consumer-first mindset. And also for the outside, we're going to get a lot of more partners. We expect to double the amount of API partners in the coming year. More wishes and requirements. It's one team of actually four people. That's actually four people being responsible for almost half the revenue of bol.com. That's unscalable, but from a business perspective also might not be the wisest thing. But how to move forward? That's the question. And so I started with an overview of bol.com and the ambition, followed by the retailer API and the challenges there. But how will we achieve our ambition when the organization is not set up properly? So that's part three, and it starts with a bit of history you might have heard before. So when you have an IT scalability journey, in 1999, we started with waterfall, monoliths, centralized. We had a hosting company. Now, all the stuff you could do really quickly with a few big applications. But over the years, you started growing and growing until you end up with 150 Scrum teams, over 1,000 API components. You want to do 100 deliveries a day, and we're moving towards the cloud. So this is about a scalability journey, and that reflects also from an architectural perspective. You see here sort of the evolution of architecture, where on the left, you see that we could still write down architecture on the back of a coaster. And on the top right, we have sort of the software parade, which is an automated IT landscape insights tool. And you'll see there that we have, like I said, over 1,001 applications and 150 teams. So we grew incredibly fast. And this is also basically Conway's law in action, right? We set up the IT and architecture to support organizational goals. But in our incredibly fast growth, you do it a lot of growing pace as well. So when you look at it, what we end up with is this, right? This is sort of our IT landscape. So this is sort of all the car parts, all the microservices you can imagine. You end up with a lot of loose parts, but they over the time lost their cohesion from a process and consumer perspective. It's like going to a gas station and trying to fill up your tank, but in our case, you would have to know how to build the pump first before you can actually start filling up. So let me give you a bit of an example. So if you're a customer and you buy something, you want to know where my package is. So we have a system that can answer that question. But from our perspective, we needed, I think in that case, maybe 10 or 11 or 12 services from a channel perspective. And they need to hook all those services together and still build a bit of business logic, because the actual business logic of where's my package was sort of lost over the years. Because you just couldn't find the stuff you need anymore quickly. I just want to know where my package is. The second challenge is we have so many dependencies. That if you want to change just something a bit, or maybe even a small part of your API, then suddenly you find out that 50 services are relying on you. That's simply not feasible to move forward. And also maybe the most important one for this talk is we have difficulty exposing all that stuff externally, right? What a partner expects is mostly not what we can expose, because we still have that inside out or a GUI mindset on a micro level. So there's no focus on the macro or process level. So it's difficult to expose a process or a complete functionality to a consumer where things are splintered on the inside. I don't understand. So this is basically how it ends up, sort of our own Death Star architecture that we have. So we have the missing overview with so many interconnected parts. It's hard to find the service you need for your innovation. Limiting the autonomy of teams through so many dependencies. And this is really slowing down our transition to a retail tech platform if you can't connect partners and other third parties to your systems, right? So in the end, to solve for this, we are taking the next steps to our innovation journey. I heard another talk talking about this one part as well. So we want to transition to a product organization to support our ambition to become a retail tech platform. Like I said, we were slowing down on innovation speed. We had too many dependencies and too many people needing too much coffee to get the smallest things done. So we needed a way to minimize and manage the dependencies. And this is where a person called, I don't know if you heard of him, Klaus Leopold helped out. But we were also really inspired by the builder, by Melissa Perry, as a means of realizing that product organization and then moving to a retail tech platform. So we can have another talk on this one, but what it basically means is that what you do is a product bundles functionality based on their goal and value creation in combination with the technical capabilities and dependencies. So it's sort of like mini companies with a purpose and focus. And why, again, do we want to do this? Well, the first one is create an overview. So clarity on which products you need for which topics on consumer for consumer needs. But also freedom to organize your services inside the products as long as your API is working and innovate faster by connecting to other product APIs versus many services. And also the most important one for this context, APIs make it easy to expose functionalities and data in a structured more and structured a more reliable and predictable manner to our partners, or at least that's what we try to do. And also following Conway's law, like if this is what we want to do, we need an architecture that supports these goals. Now, it's again too much detail for now. I'm happy to talk about it some more, how we did it from an architecture perspective. Well, we created five guiding principles. And the most important one is two, where we try to incorporate the awareness and responsibility when it comes to external consumers and to solve the challenges that the API team faces. Again, because the API team right now can't solve everything for everyone. And I think my colleague or almost ex-colleague made this statement. If you want to actually become a retail tech platform with an API first ingrained in your DNA, you need to move to the product-oriented technology company. Otherwise, it'll remain what it is right now, and that won't help us move forward. But yeah, that's all nice and well, right? Will all this new structure, this new product organization solve our API problems? Is it really the silver bullet that we're hoping for? Or is it just old wine in new bags? And I've heard a lot of critique also internally, like, yeah, isn't it the smart, more the second one? So how will this really help? That's sort of the interesting journey that we're on right now. And from a more IT perspective, again, this is the structure I showed you earlier. But again, we want to move forward to only having great product APIs that are exposed through the merchant API. But if you really want to have a more scalable organization, then you need to be able to move towards a more federated model where product teams can be more autonomous. However, at the moment, that's simply not possible. We don't have that correct mindset yet. And we're starting that, but we need to do a lot of stuff. But if you want to do a more federated model, the challenge is to keep your developer experience agnostic of how this is done and deliver an API that really consumers love to use with a great developer experience. Hopefully the level 5 maturity Kathleen was talking about. And it takes us to three things we still need to do in our or in the process of doing right now. So the first part is, we need to create that inside-out mindset because we still, like I said, we still see API design which reflect a GUI wizard sometimes or something, sometimes another complete understanding of what it means for consumers to actually program against an API. And people often know what consumers want and a bit how they work, but actually making the translation between how they work and what they want to a proper API design, which is long-lasting, then that gets lost in translation. So creating an outside-in mindset. The second one is to set up an API and data governance, right? I like this phrase, making the right things easy and the bad things hard. If you let autonomous teams run loose, we really love autonomy, but on an API level, you can't really have that because you end up with a bad developer experience. I think one of the CTOs of Zalando made that statement as well a few years ago. So we have to set up a way in which you can better help teams. And although we value autonomy, we value consistent and easy to understand long-lasting APIs and a great developer experience more. And the third part is improve on the self-service digital partnership. I really like that phrase because it's really about partnership. So we want to have an optimal developer experience with a proper developer portal, key management, demo environment, etc. Everything needs a partner. Everything a partner needs to integrate with us as quickly and easy as possible. But also enable the internal product teams, right? If you want to move to product organization, you have product teams and a federated model in which product teams can expose their own APIs. And then you have to provide the means and the tooling to create that environment in which they can do that. So we have lots of pieces of the puzzle, but now we need to connect them. And shameless plug, we could really use an architect on this part. So let me know if you're interested. But this is something that we're in the process of doing. And it's hard for a company that started 20 years ago with a user interface in mind, which is how we got so big and so far. But our next step is sort of really a mind shift. It takes me to the takeaways. So I have three takeaways. So the first one is, won't be a surprise, but in Sustainable DX, you can have all the tooling and guidelines. We have all those things, but if you don't have an organization with an API-first mindset from top to bottom, then it's not going to work in the long run. You can maybe brush up, have a nice site, but that won't work in the long run, especially with our ambitions. I also talked a bit about the federated model and that we need to move towards that, but it's really important that you really make clear on how you want to organize the ownership and responsibility regarding the public API part. Do you have a team like us, maybe a much bigger team that will do all the stuff, or will the downstream product teams also get that responsibility? So how will you organize that? That's really important to decide, but also make clear to everyone to avoid mishaps. And the third part is, I don't think that'll be a surprise for everyone, but changing API awareness, especially for a company that's been around longer, takes a lot of time. And you can evolve IT and businesses, and they will, and we're doing that with Q&A sessions, and we have an API game workshop, etc. But if the goals and the purpose of business and IT are not aligned to having an API-first mindset, then you won't get anywhere. And that takes lots and lots and lots and lots of time. So that brings me to the end of the talk. So it's really fascinating and interesting to see and hear passionate people talk about these topics. And I hope you enjoyed the story and found it interesting. And if you want to talk some more, then feel free to contact me.
Thank you, Maarten. There were a lot of really interesting points. And it's really exciting to see that there's some reverberation of some of the interface ideas and like the decoupled teams with interfaces as a way to do agiles at scale. That's really, really exciting. We unfortunately don't have time for questions on the live podium, but maybe if there's any questions, you can drop them in the stage chat, and maybe you can hang around a little bit more.
Yes, I will.
Okay, thank you very much.